there was a Christian couple. Both husband and wife were doctors. The husband was a preacher. He had done his doctorate in theology, whereas the wife was a practicing medical, a doctor. Now, whenever someone wanted to meet one of them, she would tell the maidservant, "I want to meet Dr. D'Souza." The maidservant would ask the person, "Which doctor do you want to meet? The one who practices or the one who preaches?" The gospel writer Luke portrays Mary as the one who practices her faith through her outgoing love as she visits her aged relative Elizabeth. We read about it in Luke chapter 1, verses 39 to 45, which is the theme for our reflection, the fifth session in our series of infancy narratives. Luke says, "In those days Mary set out and went with haste to a Judean town in the hill country, where she entered the house of Zechariah and greeted Elizabeth. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the child leaped in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit." Now, does the gospel writer Luke only want to tell us about this visit of Mary to only show her love in action? Or is there a deeper significance to this event? This incident of John the Baptist leaping in his mother's womb is reminiscent of King David, who had leaped and danced before the Ark of the Covenant. Now, the Ark of the Covenant was captured by the Philistines, and David defeats them, and he manages to retrieve and bring the Ark back to Israel. And he brings it back with great pomp and splendor. He himself leaps and dances with gay abandon before the Ark of the Covenant. Now, when John the Baptist leaped in his mother's womb, the gospel writer Luke is telling us that now Mary is the Ark of the New Covenant, before whom John the Baptist is doing that little jig, that dance in his mother's womb. And it was prophesied to Zechariah that John the Baptist will be filled with the Holy Spirit even from his mother's womb, in Luke chapter 1, verse 14, and that he would prepare the people of Israel for the coming of the Messiah, for the coming of the Lord. And the very first person whom John the Baptist prepares is his own mother. It is through his leaping that Elizabeth recognizes, she too is filled, as he leaps, she is also filled with the Holy Spirit. And she recognizes not only the Lord, and also she also recognizes the mother of her Lord. And she exclaims, saying, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb." Now this exclamation, this statement that she makes, is a part of the Hail Mary. The Hail Mary consists of exclamations by two beings. One is a heavenly being, that is the angel Gabriel, and the other is the earthly being, Elizabeth. "Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you," and Elizabeth adds to it, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb." And the title of Jesus is added to what Elizabeth said. These words are used to coin the Hail Mary, as I said. Now, the Hail Mary is a scriptural prayer, and in the Rosary, it is uttered 50 times. Now, in the Joyful Mystery, we have the five events of Jesus' life, and all these five events are reflected in the infancy narratives in Luke's Gospel. The first mystery being the Annunciation to Mary, the second Joyful Mystery, the Visitation, the third mystery, the Birth of our Lord, the fourth mystery, the Presentation of our Lord, and the fifth mystery, the finding of our Lord in the temple. So when we pray the Rosary, we are in effect reflecting on the infancy narratives, the events in the life of Jesus. As we read further, Elizabeth said, "And why has this happened to me, that the mother of my Lord comes to me? For as soon as I heard the sound of your greeting, the child in my womb leaped for joy. And blessed is she who believed that there would be a fulfillment of what was spoken to her by the Lord." Mary is said to be blessed not only because she was the biological mother of Jesus, but also because she obeyed the word of God. Later on in Jesus' ministry, when a woman cries out from the crowd, she says, "Blessed is the womb that bore you and the breast that nourished you, nursed you." Jesus says, rather, blessed are those who hear the word of God and obey it. Luke chapter 11 verses 27 and 28. Jesus in effect is saying that Mary is blessed not only because she is his biological mother, but also because she obeyed the word of God. Hence, Mary is presented to us as the model believer. And that's why Elizabeth too says that blessed is she who believed, because there will be a fulfillment of what was told to her by the Lord. Now, before we wrap up this chapter, we will be dealing with the Magnificat in a later session. But before we close this chapter, we will dwell on a couple of insights more. One of the insights is that the Holy Spirit is an important theme, the third person of the Blessed Trinity. An important theme in the Gospel according to St. Luke. The same Luke will further develop on the role of the Holy Spirit in the public ministry of Jesus. In this chapter itself, Luke mentions the Holy Spirit four times with regard to all the four characters mentioned in this infancy narrative. Firstly, John is said to be filled with the Holy Spirit even from his mother's womb in Luke chapter 1 verse 14. Then we see Mary, to whom it was told, the Holy Spirit will come upon you and the power of the Most High shall overshadow you. That is Luke 1:35. And then again we have Elizabeth in verse 41. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the child leaped in her womb and she was filled with the Holy Spirit. Then again we have the fourth person, that is Zechariah in Luke 1 verse 67. Then his father Zechariah was filled with the Holy Spirit and spoke this prophecy. So all four are filled with the Holy Spirit. God chose very simple, humble people in order to minister to his son and all who are connected with the birth of his son. But he made no mistake. They were filled with the Holy Spirit. And it is the Holy Spirit who makes all that difference in our lives. It is only left to us to open ourselves to his action. Another point is that the good news of Jesus brings joy in our lives. It was said about John that there will be rejoicing at his birth, and that is fulfilled in verse 57, where it says, "The neighbors and relatives heard that the Lord had shown him his great mercy to Elizabeth, and they rejoiced with her," in verse 58. So joy is a hallmark of a Christian. And even as John was supposed to be the precursor of Jesus, so we too are called to lead people to Jesus through our words and deeds. Now in verse 80, this particular chapter closes with this summary verse. It says, "The child grew and became strong in spirit, and he was in the wilderness until the day he appeared publicly to Israel." In Isaiah 49 verse 2, it was prophesied that God has made me a polished arrow and hidden me in his quiver. John is now in the preparatory stage. God is as if keeping him hidden until the time of his public manifestation to Israel. It takes time for us to reach a point where God can use us. Of course, God can use any person, but God has his own time. David was supposed to have been 16 years of age when the prophet Samuel anointed him. But it was only at the age of 30 that he was crowned king. There is a period of formation before one launches out into ministry. Even Jesus showed exceptional wisdom at the age of 12, but it wasn't yet time for him. He was baptized only at the age of 30. Now, as we recap what we have just reflected on, we see Mary reaches out in love to her cousin Elizabeth, to a relative, and she is presented as the Ark of the New Covenant. We've seen the prayer, the rosary, encapsulates the joyful mysteries in the life of Jesus. The five mysteries are all found in the infancy narrative. So when we pray it, we are in effect meditating on these aspects of Jesus' conception and birth. We've seen that the good news of Jesus brings joy. And all the four characters mentioned in this first chapter are filled with the Holy Spirit. And that is it was the Holy Spirit who made a difference in their lives, and through them, a difference in the world. And just like John, we are called to be precursors, to prepare the way for others, to lead them to the Lord Jesus. Thank you.